So I want to welcome everybody for joining us today for UI Voices. As some of you know, and those for you joining us for the first time today, welcome. One of the main purposes of UI Voices is to bring together leading voices in the world of social impact to discuss issues and problems, and really most importantly, the solutions. This hopefully sheds light on something new, really for all of us to learn. And today's topic, investing in diverse founders, is no different. In 2020, venture-backed companies raised $130 billion, with only 2.6% of capital going to minorities and 2.2% going to women. And at University Impact, we strive as an organization to be inclusive in our impact investments and foster networks for founders to access. And we know that we can always strive to be better and want to learn from others. So our two guests today, Danielle Brown and Marlon Evans, are leaders at the nexus of elevating and investing in minority founders. They will share their perspectives, one as an investor and one as a leader in finding and accelerating entrepreneurs. So first I'll kind of give you a little bit about their background. So Danielle Brown has 20 years experience in hedge funds, private equity, and private credit sectors. In her current role as CEO of Altriarch, she leads the firm's alternative investing platform, which includes investing in overlooked markets in underserved geographies, fragmented industries, or even small-scale market segments. In her previous role as managing director at Dial Capital Partners, she was responsible for strategic planning, fundraising, and operational efficiencies within their portfolio companies. She helped grow their fund from $1 billion to $15 billion across four funds. Welcome, Danielle.
Thanks, John.
And we're also joined by Marlon Evans, whose career has spanned higher education, foundations, Fortune 500s, and startups, always with a desire to create positive social impact. As the CEO of NextCube, he leads an organization which empowers entrepreneurs to bring new technologies to market, helps rising company scale, and provides paths to liquidity. Really a power of three. Their portfolio consists of 80 startups with $500 million in aggregate value, and over 50% of their portfolio are led by women and minority founders. Last year, NextCube launched the HBCU Founders Initiative, and this is the first startup accelerator to inspire entrepreneurship at historically Black colleges and universities here in the U.S. Previously, Marlon was CEO of GSV Labs, now named One Valley, a global innovation platform that accelerates startups. Plus, he's also worked at the HP Company Foundation. So lots to learn from these two, rich experience, and I'm excited to have our conversation today. So welcome, Danielle and Marlon.
Thanks for having me.
We're happy to be here.
Yay, great. So we'll have some time over the next, I guess now it's about 40 minutes. So just for everyone in the audience, we're going to have, you know, a really kind of open Q&A or discussion back and forth, and we'll have time for Q&A at the end. So for those of you, I said this before, and those of you joining us now, if you have questions along the way, please put them into the chat or the Q&A, and we'll pose those questions at the end to Marlon and Danielle. So great. So I want to begin our conversation first by getting a high level understanding of the why. I love the why for NextCube and Altriarch. And so we know that there's this systemic issue of underfunding of minority founders, yet your organizations have a higher proportion of minority and women founders in your portfolios, whether from accelerating or investing. And, you know, can both of you share with us the purpose behind why inclusivity is important for your firms? So maybe Marlon, let's start with you first.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's, you know, there's obviously the double bottom line aspect of it in terms of, you know, both being able to create a lasting social impact. But I think sometimes folks fail to understand the return on investment opportunity as well. It's just been proven over and over. McKinsey has done studies. There have been others that more diverse teams are more profitable teams, you know, upwards of 25, 30%. So if I told you as an investor, you could have invested a company that's going to generate more than 25-30% terms that, returns than average, you know, typically we say, great, that's the type of company that I want to be a part of. So we start obviously at a very early stage, but our thesis is if we can find really talented, you know, founders who are building diverse teams, that ultimately those teams are going to be even more successful in the long run.
Yeah, agrees. And Danielle, how about from kind of Altriarch's perspective and your and what you're investing in?
Yeah, I think whether it's affordable housing, like you mentioned, or just evaluating and looking for opportunities and overlooked demographics, for me and my team, it's hugely important that we focus on the positive impact that we have. Mm-hmm. You know, Marlon hit the nail on the head saying, you know, we are in the asset management business and industry. We need to make profits and returns for our investors. But I think in this day and age, and what personally gets me excited is looking in these underserved areas and overlooked demographics for those good returns and for the opportunity to invest in them and have a double impact. I think, you know, as somebody who, you know, spent 20 years in this industry and has had the experiences of being pigeonholed and going into interviews or looking for jobs saying, oh, you're female in this industry. Are you looking to raise money? You know, are you capital raising or just that? And then always having to overcome like, no, I've had over a decade of investing experience and I've helped run companies. And yes, I have done marketing as well, but that's not the only thing I do. You know, I think having firsthand experience with being pigeonholed and being overlooked for opportunities on the investment side has really made me aware of the unconscious bias that we all have. Mm-hmm. And I think we'll talk a bit more about that today, Joellen, as we prep for the call. But I think, so I'm building a company that is open and inclusive to all opportunities where we can sit down together with people who challenge each other to say, mm-hmm. Marlon, why did you make that decision? Or how did you reach that conclusion? And we want to have open dialogue. So that, to me, the why of why we're building our Altriarch the way we are is the culmination of my 20 years of experience, both personal as an investor and professional.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, there's so much there, I think, to kind of unpack from everything that you said, because there's like the business case, but diversity of thinking of why wouldn't you have that? I think we talk about that a lot at University Impact of critical and independent thinking, but having that those diverse minds come to the table as we're looking at investments. They really do, having students, you know, we have people from on our team from South Africa, from India, and internally, it brings a really different perspective on lived experience and then experience of action and what we do to what we're looking for and what we invest in. And one of the things that I wanted to kind of touch on here is, Danielle, you mentioned kind of the, you know, you actually, you know, looking in those underserved areas, but that I think, Marlon, it's, you know, you're having this talent in building these diverse teams. And I think what you've both shown is that it's out there, but we hear, I think, this narrative out there that there's a pipeline problem of minority founders. And I think that's really like, there aren't enough of them. But I always think there's a lot of great ideas out there in the world. And I've met, you know, different, you know, minority founders, and like you, Danielle, I'm a woman, and Marlon, you're come from a minority background as well. Like we're all out there. So clearly, I don't know if this isn't really the case, but I'm curious of what your thoughts are on why this narrative, I think, persists, especially so much in kind of the investing space, that there's this pipeline problem. So maybe, Danielle, you can kind of shed some light on this from an investor point of view.
Yeah, I think it's a continuation of that unconscious bias. You know, like tends to attract like, and there's mm-hmm. certain comfort and a certain ease in working with people who are familiar to ourselves, and that connecting base and the folks that we interact with and how we make connections and introductions to each other just kind of perpetuates the current underfunding or the current awareness of minority-owned businesses and female-owned businesses. Mm-hmm. You know, in the Altriarch pipeline currently, I'm looking at, I think it's five companies in my pipeline. Three of them are female founders. One is founded by a Black gentleman and one's run by a white guy. Mm-hmm. And that's not that I set out to find these women-owned or minority-owned companies, because, you know, as I was saying in the beginning, as an asset manager, my goal is to invest in good companies and make returns. And we're not only focused on female or minority-owned companies, but they came to me, to us, to AltriArc through referrals. And I think that that's an example of people who say, oh, this is a wonderful female founder. Danielle runs Danielle is a female-owned asset manager and allocator. I'm going to connect the two of them, because they think there's an automatic connection there, because we have the connection of the same gender or same race or same whatever it is. They make those referral systems, and they tend to become streamlined or pipelined within a particular ecosystem. And so I think it's that, you know, people are comfortable introducing like to like, and we're continuing. And I check myself on this all the time, is am I thinking large enough? You know, and I think Marlon and I work on a number of initiatives together, and I actually caught myself doing the same thing with his HBCU Founders Fund that he wants to launch. So I immediately went to the other minority owned PE firms who would be interested in this and passed it along to them, which, while that's great, I should have been like, Marlon, I have 15 other founders in the ecosystem, other investors who are interested in this, who happen to be white men, because that is the bulk of the founders and or the funders, excuse me, within the industry. So I think it's a constant checking of ourselves and making sure that we're thinking broadly and that we're not perpetuating this pipeline fallacy.
Yeah, I really like that. And I like that that check yourself. And, and now I'm trying to think, like, in my head really quickly, I'm like, when have I done that? Because I know I've done that as well. I've done that same thing that you've just described, kind of, you know, assuming that those people that I already know would already like that, instead of saying, no, I'm going to take it to everybody in different ways. And Marlon, what are your thoughts on this? I'd like to kind of get some of your perspective.
Yeah, I think Danielle hit it on the head. It's not a pipeline problem. It's a network problem. If you
that was typically... said much more succinctly than me, Marlon.
No, you teed me up really, really well. I mean, there was, you know, countless, you know, times I've heard, well, I'm only going to invest in things that I can feel and touch, that are in my backyard, or I can go meet with the founder, or that was been referred to me by somebody who I trust. And if you're not running in those circles, or if your circles are limited to just people that look like yourself, then you're only going to see those deals. So yeah, it's just really about being very, you know, intentional about saying that you are open and inclusive to looking at opportunities that may not fit the standard pattern that you've evaluated opportunities in the past. And once you kind of open up to that, you know, notion, you'll start to see a lot of deals coming your way. But it definitely does take you stepping out probably a little bit outside of your comfort zone and expanding your network.
Yeah. Okay. So you said the word evaluating, like the pattern on evaluating. I'm going to throw this one for you. Are there ways that people have to think about changing, you know, what are those ways that people really kind of need to kind of change that pattern, or what pattern, you know, that framework that we're actually using right now really maybe doesn't work? And what might we have to change, you know, an investor might have to change? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, almost everything. I mean, but it's right. I mean, there's pattern recognition, and it's what's worked in the past. And you have this kind of archetype or prototype of, you know, opportunity that you've seen, and you say, oh, the person was, they came from this university, and they had access to this type of capital. And you know, investment is all about risk mitigation, because you know, inherently you're taking a risk on investing in an opportunity that doesn't have a tremendous amount of traction. So you're looking for those signals, and it's really about just kind of rewiring and saying, well, yes, that has worked in the past and it may work in the future, but that doesn't mean that a completely different opportunity from a different background can't be as successful. So yeah, I'm sure Danielle can speak to that as well. But it is about really just thinking about being more open to seeing different patterns and mm-hmm. understanding that that can be just as successful.
Yeah. Thank you. And then thinking about that and continuing on that pipeline, and just as we can kind of talk about this and kind of creating that and creating those opportunities for entrepreneurs, opening up those networks. You know, one of the programs that NextCube did launch was the HBCU Founders Initiative. And so I was hoping that you could even kind of just tell us, you know, why did you kind of focus in on this initiative? I think we can kind of understand maybe the reason behind it, but just kind of dig into that program a little bit more on, you know, how it's countering maybe this pipeline fallacy and what it's doing in opening up these, you know, these entrepreneurs access to a broader range of investors.
Yeah, when as you mentioned earlier in the lead-in, we've at NextCube have always focused on having a very diverse and inclusive portfolio, not exclusively, but mm-hmm. it's been something that's been a part of our investment thesis. But even though we start at that pre-seed stage level, so very, very early, we were requiring companies to have come to us having raised friends and family angel funding, which meant if you didn't have access to the rich uncle or somebody in your network who could provide funding, you weren't even able to get to our front door. So that didn't, we felt like we were, there was more that we could do to help increase the top of the funnel. And so we said to ourselves, where can we go where there's a lot of talent? HBCUs. They're creating 30% of all STEM grads, African-American STEM grads are coming from HBCUs. You have folks like our vice president who are hailing from HBCUs. So you know there's a tremendous amount of talent, you know, there, but they don't, not all of them have access to that early stage kind of pre-acceleration, pre-seed type funding. And it's not due to lack of talent or ideas. It's just those ideas are dying on the vine because there's no resource there to help cultivate it. So we decided to make sure that if we could play a role in helping inspire entrepreneurship at HBCUs and help them kind of cross that chasm, that really early stage chasm, so that we are mitigating some of that risk for an investor who hasn't typically invested in companies coming from rural North Carolina.
Yeah.
Then we could help really increase that, you know, top of the funnel and address the pipeline, you know, fallacy.
Right. And so then just get a little bit more specific. What are some of the, I guess, the programs that you have right now, maybe that might be in action right now with some of the founders coming out of HBCUs?
Yeah. So what we found is that there was a lot of point in time activities, and increasingly post George Floyd, there was a lot of corporations that wanted to do work in particular at HBCUs, which was awesome. But typically it was limited. There was over 100 HBCUs across the country, and typically it was limited to maybe ones that folks have heard on the line, Howard, Spelman, Morehouse, but there's still 97 plus other ones. And then, like I said, they were focused on maybe a pitch competition here or a hackathon events, but nothing where there was that kind of connective tissue to say, okay, now what? I have this great idea. What do I do? How do I keep it going? So we launched a virtual accelerator program where you go through an 8-week curriculum. You get an understanding of customer discovery, fundraising, just all of the blocking and tackling, helping to create your pitch deck, you know, such that when you come out of it, you're in a better place to be able to go get that first kind of funding. And now that we've seen, it's just a tremendous amount of response across, you know, 50 plus now 60 HBCUs, and we're seeing the amount of amazing talent and teams where teaming up with Danielle and Altiar to raise a fund to invest in companies that have at least one founder who's an HBCU student or alum.
Well, that's,
I was just going to say, Joellen, that's where Altiar comes in. And I think where while there's no formal affiliation between NextCubed and UltriArc, we have a tremendous working partnership. And so the successes that come out of Marlon's program, I personally love, because I kind of get like first dibs. Like, he's like, hey, this company is doing really, really great. They need to raise their first convertible note, first institutional capital. They're looking for real pre-seed from institutions, and UltriArc can take a look at that company coming out of his accelerator, out of NextCubed, and say, that one's for us.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that what they're doing, the work that NextCube is doing, really helps promote and improve that pipeline, and makes it more public for funders, pre-seeders, seeders, and even Series A investors.
Yeah. And I just get more questions coming to mind, but I think that's, you know, thank you for making that connection, because one of the other questions that I actually had was about when we now start kind of narrowing in and looking actually who the funders are. And I love that, because one of my questions to you, Danielle, was going to be like, what are some practical examples? Because we always hear about like, what are the trends and like, how do we stop this? But I like to hear these, and I'm sure everyone does, these practical examples of how people are working together and building ecosystems. And so that's just one example that you just gave. But I'd love to hear kind of other examples, practical actions that you're taking at UltriArc to kind of kind of counter this trend.
Yeah, I think for UltriArc and for me personally, a big solution to it is simply corporate culture. A place where we internally at UltriArc can say, I don't have the answer. I don't know what that means. And we work together as a group. And I think that translates to entrepreneurs who come to us and we talk about maybe raising their Series A for them or just helping them through the process. It creates a very safe place when you sit down in our conference room and you're having conversations about your first institutional capital as an entrepreneur. You're not uncomfortable to ask questions to the UltriArc team that maybe you would be to a larger, more well-known funder or somebody who's more intimidating in the industry. And I think just, you know, having a female across the table from them, they're maybe more comfortable to say, what's a liquidation preference? What does that mean to me? How is that happen in practicality when it comes to that point in my company's life cycle? What would that look like? I think certain environments create a safer space for people to admit they don't know it all, or they have difficult questions that they would like some guidance on. And so for me, building that corporate culture at UltriArc is very, very important, because I think that creates a really healthy ecosystem of people who are all driving towards a good purpose, you know, profitable, impactful, helpful company within communities and corporations.
Yeah. I like that you said that with a purpose and profitable and all that, and within a good corporate culture, because it can all exist together. It doesn't have to be an and or. I think it can be, you know, an and. But it's, yeah, I think it do. I can kind of agree with you there, like that corporate culture, and how do you foster that with everyone? So they're all having that kind of guiding star, that objective, and that mindset to kind of think that way. Thank you for sharing that. And Marlon, I think from your perspective, when we think about the funders and the investors out there, right, they are majority white and male. We've kind of talked about that already. And in our preparatory discussions, we were kind of really having kind of some candid and open conversations, and knowing that Danielle is a white female, but that people are really kind of comfortable coming to talk to her and kind of work with her. And this, you know, this creates a certain dynamic. And you had some really valuable insights into that from an outside perspective, you know, so Danielle's kind of talked about, I think, and shared with everyone what she's been doing. And she's talked about the attracts likes, I may be messing that up, but how that whole dynamic. But I'd love to get your perspective on, you know, knowing that Danielle is a fund, you know, an investor and funding things. Why do people, and as she's talked about, why do people come kind of really and feel, from your perspective and having talked to entrepreneurs, would they feel comfortable coming to talk to and work with Danielle?
Yeah, and I think she just hit it. I mean, in terms of the culture that's been created at UltriArc, where it's very much a, you know, we're not sitting across the table from you, you know, with the Yoda with all the answers and, you know, directing, but it's more of a collegial, you know, partnership in mm-hmm. that sense. And so that can't be, you know, shifted at all in terms of the importance of that engagement with entrepreneurs who, yeah, they realize there is a power dynamic. They're coming and asking for money in, you know, at the end of the day. And, you know, how can you as an investor almost flip that and say, no, actually you're bringing me an opportunity. Like, thank you for, you know, knocking on my door, because this is what, you know, why I wake up every day, is to support great entrepreneurs. So I say there's definitely an intentionality there. But then the second thing is just more practical. We tell our startups all the time, like, look at who is investing in your space and other, you know, founders, and get an understanding of what their portfolio is like. And if they see that there's diversity within their portfolio, they say, well, if I'm a diverse founder, they're probably open to hearing my, you know, my pitch. So it's a very almost small thing you can do initially to just say, okay, you have to start from somewhere. And, you know, making an investment, however small or however large, in a female founder, in a minority founder, is a signal to the market that this is something that you're open to doing. And then inevitably you'll start seeing more and more opportunities that are from diverse entrepreneurs.
Yeah. And then, you know, in thinking about kind of all that and the funders and investors from both your perspectives, what are some of the trends, I think, that are out there that you both seeing kind of from an investor perspective, but even from an accelerator standpoint, you know, beyond kind of looking at both the two of your kind of organization, but what else is happening out there? What are some exciting things and maybe not so exciting things that you've kind of seen in this space for entrepreneurs and investing in diverse founders?
And I'll just say that not even specifically just diverse founders, just the expectation of investors wanting to see more and more traction before they kind of cut that initial check. So what used to be kind of Series A type performance expectations are now being pushed down to the seed, and seed is pushing down on the pre-seed, would put even more pressure on the entrepreneurs to be able to scale their businesses very quickly, because, you know, they're always going to be resource, you know, constrained, and it's the chicken and the egg. I need money in order to fuel the business. So that's where we try to step in for, as an accelerator, really help accelerate that growth for those startups so that they can come out of it enterprise ready, investor ready, to be able to check some of those boxes that the investors are increasingly asking for. So I don't think that's necessarily a great trend, but it's where we exists. Are right now.
Yeah, it exists right now. Yeah. And you have to be able to kind of manage against that and work with the entrepreneurs and work with them through that. Danielle, what about from your side?
I guess the trend that immediately comes to mind is actually for my own asset raising mm-hmm. capital for AltGR for us to deploy into the great companies that Marlin's developing. There's all of these initiatives, and a lot of it's being driven by some of the large public pensions around mm-hmm. making sure that we're investing in asset management companies managed by minorities or women. And the unfortunate reality is that a lot of these things are being papered but not acted upon quite yet. And so I'm very hopeful that the conversation is very frothy right now. There's a lot of them. New York State Common is probably one of the biggest that has it. New Jersey as well has the kind of these mandates to invest in women-owned and minority-owned asset mm-hmm. management companies. But you're not quite seeing the money be put to work yet. And I think that the parallel with what Marlin said on that is many of the asset management firms like AltGR, we are smaller and we're newer and we're emerging. And firms like New York Common or even the state of Wisconsin, they have to go to their consultant, Cliffwater or whoever it is, and say, we want to invest in this minority-owned, women-owned asset management firm. They only manage $100 million, but we think they're great. it's a really difficult decision for somebody like a Cliffwater or Cambridge to say, yes, let's do that, because if something goes wrong, they're going to get fired. No one gets fired for investing in the top 50 asset management firms. You know, so to Marlon's point, I liked what he said earlier that, you know, everything we can do as an industry to help mitigate some of those risks for the bigger players will perpetuate and help improve this problem that we've seen in underfunding women and minorities.
Yeah.
Because whether it's we don't have the pedigree, whether we don't have the balance sheet or the size, that is a chicken and egg problem that we need to continuously work at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's, you know, you can ask kind of the bigger fish in the sea to kind of make accommodations and everything, but we are managing against that risk. And I like to, in hearing you, the conversation about this reminds me of that kind of like this managing up when you kind of think about work, but how do you kind of create the scenarios where you make it easy for others to participate in what you, in the change that you want to create, right? So that's just an interesting kind of perspective. So thank you for sharing those insights with us. And then kind of moving into an area that I noted earlier that we were talking about, and it was about the biases and those unconscious biases that we we all have them, right? And how that impacts, you know, who, you know, we might look at, who we might share, you know, deal flow with, or and all that. So, Danielle, I want to start with you here, but I know it's a kind of a reflective question, I would think, for all of us. So even for the audience here, of how we can kind of think about it ourselves. It's, you know, how do we kind of dig in deep and think about what are our own biases and how we might perpetuate a cycle? And so, you know, what are your thoughts more on how we kind of can check our own biases, and whether as investors, and then Marlon, even as from your perspective, I'd like to know this from your perspective, how you can kind of check your own biases. And I know, Danielle, you said a little bit before of kind of some of the things that you've done, but anything else that you have about, you know, tools that we can use to kind of check our own biases, or things that we can do to kind of create that inclusive and diverse system.
I think that the topic of unconscious bias to me is just really interesting, really fascinating, because it colors our day-to-day interactions with everyone. And I think the first step in kind of resolving the problems unconscious bias creates is simply awareness. You know, just be aware that we have an unconscious bias and that we might be bringing an unconscious bias to the table and the way that we interact and make decisions. And I think I should say here that unconscious bias is not always negative. Mm-hmm. I think it gets the rap of being negative. I think sometimes, you know, I don't want it to just be a negative thing. It can create positive scenarios as well, but we just need to be aware it's present. Mm-hmm. And I think for me, the key to checking myself, my own biases, is having a group of people around me who can question me. You know, as the leader of an organization, I think sometimes folks are maybe hesitant to question their managers and things like that. But I've always encouraged it. I actually really welcome people to say, Danielle, you know, let's talk about these decisions. You know, let's arrive at the decision together. Why did you have that reaction in the meeting? You know, what was going on there? I want that with my deputies and lieutenants around me. That's very important. I think also sometimes it touches on topics or interactions that are really uncomfortable, and that perpetuates it. Yeah. Sometimes I feel like we fail at having the language to properly talk about this sensitive subject. You know, how do we actually articulate properly that we're focused on minorities and women owned businesses, when sometimes the language we choose can unintentionally insult someone, or can unintentionally, you know, make the situation uncomfortable, or our intentions are misconstrued.
Yeah.
All of those things come into play with this. And I think people were working at it at large as a group of individuals, especially the folks probably on this call, are willing to talk about it, but it's not easy. It's uncomfortable. Yeah. And I think just being open and genuinely giving people kind of the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah.
I think we've lost that a lot in interactions with folks, but giving people the benefit of the doubt that they meant well, that their intentions are good, is important. And then surrounding yourself with people who are willing to check you.
Yeah, I like that. So yeah, especially surrounding yourself with those people who are willing to check you. Mm-hmm. Marlon, how about from your perspective?
Yeah, no, I think it's tough to follow Danielle always, because I think she hit all of the top points. And maybe I'll go for it from a different perspective. I mean, we've had a lot of conversations internally about how kind of intentional or prescriptive do we want to be in terms of communicating out that we really want to see diverse founders in our portfolio, because that could then suggest to a non-diverse founder that we don't want them to be a part of the portfolio. And actually, there can even be a greater impact if we can bring in a non-diverse founder and help them understand the value just from their own business perspective of, you know, creating that early team that looks more like, you know, the world writ large. So I guess there may be a little bit of a kind of a signaling, you know, challenge there, because I want to, every team has an opportunity to create diversity, whether you're starting with two people or you have 1,000, as long as you're open and willing, as Danielle described. So we've tried to walk that fine line of wanting to be open to everyone, but just to have all of the teams that come to us understand that our perspective is, and proven out, like I said, in the studies, that the more diverse the team is, the more high functioning and profitable it'll be.
Yeah, no, I like that the converging, it's, to me, it reminds me of just that converging of worlds. But then I also like that you noted signaling, and what does that signal? And I think that came up earlier, and even for investors on who you're investing in, and people, entrepreneurs look at that. And so all those different signals, I think that you can kind of put out into the world that shows you might not be perfect, but you're trying. And that's what we can do to kind of make this change and create an ecosystem that is more inclusive.
And I would just say, back to the unconscious bias, there is an expectation part of this, which can be, you know, even more challenging, where you make this step and you say, you know what, I'm going to make this investment in a diverse founder because I think it's the right thing to do. I'm not expecting anything to come of it. It's kind of whatever, I've checked the box, and that not just for individuals, but for corporates. On the other end, just understanding what that, again, back to the signal, what that signals to the founder. And what we found a lot of times with our students at the HBCU program is just the fact that we were taking it seriously. Like, this wasn't a theoretical exercise. It wasn't, hey, let's try to figure out and we'll, you know, see what happens. Like, no, let's see this through. This has an opportunity. And just that belief, knowing that 90% of those opportunities aren't going to be successful, but that's not how you're going into it. You're going into it thinking they're all going to be successful, and there's this expectation. And so I would just, you know, for the audience, just kind of underscore that mentality of, this isn't just like, you know, hey, the same rigor you're putting to your other parts of your portfolio should be, you know, placed there as well. And it's not, you're not making a accommodation. It's just, you know, good for the world and good for business as well.
Yeah, I think that's a really great point. Yeah. I'm just going to kind of read this kind of question and answer that kind of came up right now, because it's, I like it. So Pumzile Gobanka, she's from South Africa. She says, when Danielle was referring to the culture aspect when creating safe spaces, it reminded me of a concept that South African activist and founder of Hatch Institute, Ian Furr, champions, called culture nearing. It's a new word. So really, really almost having through an intersectional framework when carving out culture at the very fabric of an organization. It's about gender, race, class, and in South Africa's context, even various ethnic groups. The Ngunis, Sothos, and various other cultural groups. So sorry if I said that wrong. Shout out to the panelists. So thank you. Thank you, Pumzile. So just kind of conscious of time here, I'm gonna ask if please, if anyone has any other any other questions, do please kind of just chat them right away. I've loved our conversation, but kind of knowing we're kind of ending time here, I want to pose kind of just one more overarching question for all of you. And so, as you know, University Impact, we are training the next generation of social impact leaders through our impact investing training. And some of them are on the call. So Pumzile is one of them, one of our associates. So for those aspiring investors and I think social impact leaders and how they want to do business and anyone else on our call, investors, even, you know, donors who might have their donor advice fund with us, you know, what would you say to them, you know, to make themselves more available or think about these, but especially I think to the young aspiring future leaders, what words would you give to them?
Marlon, you want to go first?
Wow. So that you said that the audience is more so the entrepreneurs than investors.
Yeah.
I mean, so, and if you're in getting into social impact, you're getting into for the right reasons, I think, ultimately, in terms of the longevity of entrepreneurship. It's really, really hard. It can be very lonely at times. And the fact that you're doing something that you're passionate about and you believe in is really going to help you navigate those really difficult times and get back up and, you know, take it to that next level. So I would say just always lean into that passion that got you into it in the first place. And then secondarily, I would just say always be more focused on the problem that you're trying to solve versus the solution that mm-hmm. you think might solve that problem, because the initial idea that you had or the initial thrust of what you were trying to accomplish, it may come in different forms, and be open to that. As long as you're staying true to your North Star of the problem that you're trying to solve, be open to that. It can be solved in any number of ways.
That's great advice. I think my head went to practicalities as well. I think one, be a champion of each other. I think when you spend time promoting others around you, and I think that comes back to you. I think it is a karma thing. I do believe in that. Spend time championing others. And I think the other thing, you know, do what you say you're going to do. And that sounds like really simple advice perhaps, but it can literally be like, hey, Marlon, I'm going to call you Friday and check in. Do that, you know, just follow through with what you say you're going to do, and then people will come to rely on you, and then you can really kind of build very strong networks, and people will then champion your success. So I think maybe it's rather simple advice, but praise those around you and simply follow through on what you say you're going to do.
Oh, I love that. So we have one more question from the audience before we kind of sign off. And they ask, this is a question for both of you. What has surprised you and even your organizations the most since you have been engaged in this work, in this space, within this ecosystem, and alongside adjacent ecosystems?
What has surprised me? The perpetual difficulty of raising assets. Hmm. I think that, you know, you constantly are optimistic and hope that it gets easier and easier, but I think it's a reality of our industry, of the business. There are a lot of people vying for capital, a lot of really good people vying for capital. And so you simply just need to be diligent and persistent and believe in what you're building and keep at it. But I think there are days that I wake up and like, why is it so hard to raise access? But it just is.
Yeah, I probably shouldn't have been surprising, but the understanding that most people don't want to work really hard. Nobody really wants to roll up their sleeves. Like there's capital out there. There's commitments that are made. Daniel made the point earlier. Mm-hmm. It's not being allocated. And it's just like, they want it to just, my wife always says, magic up. Like you just want to magic this up to happen. But no, someone actually has to do the work mm-hmm. on the ground, helping to, you know, cultivate these opportunities. And that just, you know, overnight culture that I think we've created is just like, well, gosh, why haven't we changed this already? It's been 6 months. Well, it's been hundreds of years of the systemic, you know, issues that we're dealing with. So
yeah,
that's probably, you know, it shouldn't be surprising, but I just thought post kind of George Floyd and the movement that folks would realize like, no, this isn't going to happen overnight. And somebody has to do the really hard work of making a change.
Yeah. And that's exactly what I was saying when I was saying, do what you say you're going to do. Mm-hmm. Like, what's the point of putting these initiatives in at the large pension plans or the consultants saying that they want to fund diversity when they don't, you know? Right. So let's put action and hard work behind what we say we want to do. But I think it just continues to have conversations like this. And thank you to you, Joellen, and University Impact for doing this and putting this on and helping to continue the work.
Yeah, well, thank you for coming, because I think what you were talking about, you know, you're talking about digging in and it takes action to do it. And I think both of you provided concrete examples today for everyone to understand this in practice and rolling up your sleeves and doing it. It doesn't happen overnight, but you're working on it. No one claims perfection. So I think that was great. And I, you know, I took copious notes because I'm like that. And I love that, you know, the theme of checking yourself, you know, it's a networking problem, but then I, you know, what Marlon said about seeing different patterns and, you know, that kind of goes with that checking yourself. And, I love that end of it's solving the problem, not the solution, something we always too talk about here at University Impact. And also we talk about this. So Danielle, I loved it. Championing others. So important in the work that we do. So thank you so much to Marlon and Danielle for joining us today. Thank you to everyone who has come. And we hope that you can join us next month at our next University Impact. We'll be sending out a recording about this. You know, if you have any other further questions, feel free to email myself. I put my email in the chat box. What are your email or website addresses where they can find out more about that kind of NextCube and UltraArc, if you want to kind of share that quickly?
I'm sure. I'm just Danielle at ultraarc.com. So I'll just...
Yep. I can do that as well. And I'm Marlon at next3.com.
Great. And thank you. So if you have questions specifically about the programs or interested in possible investment, feel, you know, reach out or definitely contact me. So thank you so much for joining us today. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.